Mark chapter 8. Would you turn with me to Mark chapter 8? We're going to use the last several verses of chapter 8 as our text. Mark chapter 8, we'll begin reading in verse 31, and we'll read through the end of the chapter. Given a title to this message, Terms of Discipleship. Terms of Discipleship. In the last few weeks, we've been called unto Jesus Christ to accept Him as our Savior. We're going to see today that the next step is to become a disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ. Would you stand with me as we read from God's Word? Mark chapter 8, beginning in verse 31. And he began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected of the elders and of the chief priests and scribes and be killed and after 3 days rise again. And he spake that saying openly, and Peter took him and began to rebuke him. When he had turned about and looked on his disciples, he rebuked Peter, saying, Get thee behind me, Satan, for thou savorest not the things that be of God, but the things that be of men. When he had called the people unto him with his disciples also, he said unto them, Whosoever will come after me, let him deny himself, and take up his cross, and follow me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, but whosoever shall lose his life for my sake and the gospel's, the same shall save it. For what shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? Whosoever therefore shall be ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him also shall the Son of Man be ashamed when he cometh in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. Let's bow. Dear Father, we bow before you. We thank you once again, Lord, for the opportunity to be in your house, for the opportunity, God, to delve into your word and to see what you have to teach us. I just ask, Father, for clarity of thought, clarity of speech, that you might bring forth your word by your Holy Spirit, and you give us understanding, please, Father, that we would take your word and apply your word to our lives and truly become disciples, Lord. If we've been holding anything back, may this be the day that we lay it all out there for you, God, and truly be a learner, a follower, a disciple of yours. Give you preeminence, O Lord, in our life. And Father, I ask you to speak, Lord, to the lost, if there be any listening, that they would come to Jesus Christ for salvation, and your people be encouraged. It's in Jesus we pray. Amen. Terms of discipleship. I guess the first thing that we must establish is, what is a disciple? Well, someone would say, well, that's someone commissioned by Jesus to speak for him, cast out devils and heal the sick. No, my friends, those were apostles. There were a limited number of apostles for a limited time. Those who claim to be apostles today do not know the biblical qualifications for apostles. Discipleship is different. A disciple, by definition, is simply a follower or a learner. A disciple of Jesus is a follower and learner of Jesus. Every one of us who have claimed Jesus Christ as our Savior, everyone who's been saved by grace, who placed our faith and trust in Jesus, I don't know how else to term it, believers, born again, children of God, we are all to be disciples of Jesus Christ. You know, in the Bible we find many invitations. There's an invitation unto salvation. We're invited to come to Christ and be saved. We're told that all of us have a need of salvation. Unless we're already saved, we stand in need of salvation. Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. That leaves nobody out, does it? Unless we're already saved, we stand in need of salvation. We all can be accepted. Romans 10:13 said, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Whosoever is all inclusive. Anyone that will can be saved if we'll accept God's record of His Son in the Bible, in the Gospels. If we will trust in Him to be our Savior. If you have never accepted this invitation, know, my friends, that God desires for you to come to Christ and be saved. 2 Peter 3:9. He's not slack concerning His purposes. Some men count slackness, concerning His promises. As some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. It is God's desire. Listen, that's why He reached out to you in love by giving His only Son, in order that you could be saved. God's desire is for all men everywhere to be saved. That's not to say that all men everywhere will be, but you have an opportunity. So we're invited to come to Christ for salvation. We're also invited to come to Christ to find comfort. Didn't Jesus say in Matthew 11:28, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest"? We can come to Him and find the comfort, the help, and the rest that we need. We're invited to come to our Lord in times of need in prayer. Jeremiah 33:3 says, "Call unto me, and I will answer thee, and show thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not." I illustrate that verse sometimes by taking this thing out of my pocket. Sometimes I despise that thing. I mean, I refuse to carry one. I would be in a hospital room having prayer, and by the time I started to pray, it boogered ring. I just hated it. And I refused to carry it. The one my wife bought for me, I gave to my son. I hear, "You can have this thing. I'm not toting it around." But you know how my wife convinced me that I needed to keep it on me? She said, "We're not always together. Sometimes we're separated. You have to go one way and I have to go another. And I might need you." And she said, "The children might need you. Yes, they're grown and they got their own families and they're doing their own thing. But they might need you. And we need to be able to get up with you." So, okay, I relented and I keep it on me and I keep it by my side. The only time I turn it off is to reboot, and so it can update all of those things. Anyway, the point is I want an open line so that my family, for my children, can reach me. Do you know you have a Heavenly Father who always keeps an open line so that you can reach Him? He's always listening. He's desirous to hear from you when you have a need, when you have a joy, when you just want to talk. He's always there, attentive, willing, wanting to answer your call. He said, "Call unto me and I will answer thee." You're not going to get a busy signal. You're not going to get put off and say, "Call me later." Or, "Hold on, I got a more important call on the line." No, you'll be accepted every time. Isn't that great, my friends? We can call unto the Lord in times of need, in times of joy, anytime, and commune with Him. He said, "I'll show you great and mighty things which thou knowest not." Here in this text, we've seen another invitation, or we've heard another invitation come from Christ. I want us to consider for a few moments the challenging invitation to be a disciple. Just what does that mean? Well, it means that our lives will never be the same again. Consider the original disciples, those that were apostles. Consider them for a moment. What were they going to do? Go back to fishing? Peter and some of the rest of them tried that, didn't they? Couldn't catch a fish. Till Jesus got on the scene and He said, "Let down your nets there," and they did, and caught an abundant supply. But what I'm telling you, you can't go back to that old life. Once you're committed yourself totally to the Lord, you've surrendered everything to Him, there's no going back. What was Matthew Levi going to do? Go back to his table that he got up and walked away from collecting taxes? No, he wasn't going to get that job. You see, what I'm saying is their lives were forever changed. And our life will be forever changed when we become a disciple, a follower, learner of Jesus Christ. Becoming a disciple is a life-changing event. It is going the next step. It's taking the next step beyond believing in Jesus Christ as Savior, and we all need to do that. But then once we've done that, we need to take the next step to become a disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ. That means living for Christ. Too many people want to claim Christ. They want to claim to be saved. They want to claim to be His without ever living for Him, without ever becoming a disciple. And I believe they go hand in hand. I believe the one follows the other. Jesus said in verse 34 of our text, "And when He had called the people unto Him with His disciples also, He said unto them, Whosoever will come after Me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow Me." So the first challenge here, the first term of discipleship, is to forget self. Let him deny himself. Now this is not an easy challenge to accept. We're all prone to look out for number one, aren't we? We're programmed that way by this world. Even the 12 longed for the highest places, didn't they? In Mark chapter 10, just a couple pages over, listen to this. Beginning in verse 35, "And James and John, the sons of Zebedee, come unto Him, saying, Master, we would that Thou shouldest do for us whatsoever we shall desire. And He said unto them, What would ye that I should do for you? And they said unto Him, Grant unto us that we may sit the one on the right hand and the other on the left hand in Thy glory." They were wanting preeminence. They were wanting the highest places. They were looking out for number one. As a matter of fact, over and over throughout the Gospels, you find that the 12 were arguing about who should be the greatest. Jesus, in fact, told them, if you want to be the greatest, be the least. If you want to be the greatest, submit yourself and be the servant of all. That's how you be great in the kingdom of God, is be a servant. It's not what the world teaches, is it? But that's what Jesus taught. Something else here worth noting. Notice how they came. They didn't first say what they wanted. They just wanted Jesus to agree to whatever they asked. Notice that again. "Master, we would that Thou shouldest do for us whatsoever we shall desire." Hey, we want you to do us a favor. We'll tell you what the favor is after you agree to do it. You've had people do that to you, haven't you? I know you have. My daddy was the world's worst. "I wish you'd do something for me." Well, what is it? "I'm not going to agree to it until I find out what it is." "Would you do me a favor?" "I don't know. Let's hear what it is." I taught my son this early on. Don't ever agree to do anything till you find out what it is. Now, I'm not talking about following God here. Remember, they were trying to get something for themselves. You can agree to follow God. He's not going to do you wrong. He's not going to ask you to do something wrong. We need to submit to follow God. I'm talking about a person, a human being trying to trap you into something. But Jesus, of course, He wasn't going. He said, "Well, what is it you want?" You and I can be perfectly safe by submitting to God first. "Lord, I'll do whatever it is you ask." Because He's not going to ask you to do anything that would be bad for you. Anyway, He said, I'm not going to agree to that. Discipleship calls for giving Christ first place. And while we cannot or should not blindly agree to do whatever any human asks, we should go ahead and agree by faith to do whatever it is God asks, knowing that He has our best and His glory in mind. Discipleship calls for giving Christ first place. Matthew 6:33, "But seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you." What are these things? Food, raiment, shelter. These things are the necessities of life. He didn't promise every wish, every whim, every desire that you come up with, but He did promise to take care of your needs if we'll put Him and His kingdom and His righteousness first. Christ must have preeminence if we are to be His disciple. In Colossians 1, 17 and 18, "And He is before all things, and by Him all things consist, and He is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he might have the preeminence. Christ is the church's head, because he is the origin from which the church comes, the cause of her existence. Also because he's the firstborn from the dead, that is, the first to be resurrected, never to die again. Thus he should hold first place in the believer's life. This occurs when one bows to his authority, obeys his word, yields to his spirit, submits to his church leaders, does his will, and loves him supremely. Now I ask, who's on the throne in your life? Who has first place? Is it the Savior or is it self? So, the first term of discipleship was to deny self. The second one is a challenge to full surrender. Let him take up his cross. So the second term of discipleship is to take up a cross. Now the cross is about death, isn't it? It is an instrument of death. It was a means of execution. Jesus had just revealed his impending death. Look at verse 31 again. And he began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected of the elders and of the chief priests and scribes and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. So he's revealing to them his whole purpose for coming. He's going to give his life on their and our behalf and rise again for our justification. Verse 32, but Peter rebelled at the message, and he spake that saying openly, and Peter took him and began to rebuke him. Now Peter, listen, he just wanted the best for the Lord, I'm sure. He wasn't. But he began to rebuke him. Now listen to the next verse. But when he had turned about and looked on his disciples, he rebuked Peter, saying, get thee behind me, Satan, for thou savorest not the things that be of God, but the things that be of men. Peter did not yet understand God's plan of redemption. Jesus rebuked him for his resistance. Listen, Jesus is not saying that Peter is Satan or that Peter is indwelt by Satan. He's saying that Peter is speaking like Satan. Peter only wanted the best. He didn't want the Lord to die. But he didn't understand that he must die. Satan was all about stopping the cross, wasn't he? He was all about stopping the Son of God from going to the cross on our behalf. Redemption's plan. He tried it from the very beginning. He's tried from the Garden of Eden on to stop, to thwart God's redemption plan. And so what Jesus is saying is, Peter, you're speaking like Satan. You're looking at the things from human perspective, not from God's perspective. You're savoring the things of men, not the things of God. Taking up our cross does not mean that we'll die physically as Christ did. It means being willing to do the will of God in our lives. Romans 6 and verse 6. Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. So we crucify the old person with Christ. When we placed our faith and trust in Jesus, it is as if we were crucified with him on that cross. The old man, the sinful man, the flesh, was crucified with him. We're to crucify that man that the Spirit may have control in our life. In Galatians chapter 6, verse 14, But God forbid that I should glory save in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world is crucified unto me, and I unto the world. Back up a chapter. Chapter 5, 24 and 25. And they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections and lust. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Back up a couple more chapters to chapter 2 and verse 20. I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me, and the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. That kind of sums it up, don't it? That tells us about taking up our cross, about crucifying the flesh and living unto the Spirit. In other words, let the Spirit direct. Let him have control in our life. Let him drive. Quit, you know, taking the wheel and trying to drive with the flesh, but let the Spirit be the driver and direct our life. Taking up the cross is about full surrender. Christ surrendered himself to the cross to save us. You know, the Bible, Hebrews chapter 12, teaches us that he despised the shame of the cross, but he endured it for the joy that lie on the other side, for the joy of our salvation, for the joy of what the cross would accomplish, salvation of mankind. He took that shame even though he despised it. He endured it. We're to surrender to him everything. What are we holding back from our Lord? Examine our own lives. What is it that we're holding back? Have we placed limits on how far we'll go for him and with him? Lord, you not, I'll do any, oh, not that, but most anything. We're guilty of that. This is the one person, the Lord I mean, the one person that we can go ahead and say, okay, I'll do what you ask before he even tells us. The third term of discipleship, he says, follow me. Let him follow me. Only the saved can truly follow Jesus. There have been many who say they are disciples of Jesus, but they do not really follow him. Jesus makes clear in Luke 6 and 46, why call ye me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say? So if we're going to call him Lord, Lord, we need to be a follower. We need to do that which he says. The indwelling Holy Spirit makes it possible for us to do that. In the flesh we cannot, but in the Spirit we can. John 14, 17. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him, but ye know him, for he dwelleth with you and shall be in you. If you're saved, you have the Spirit. You are indwelt by the Spirit of God. You have the enablement to live for the Lord. You have the instructor, the counselor, the guide, you have the enabler to live for the Lord within you always. And so he's the one that makes it possible. Following Christ may lead through some difficult places. He may call us to go where we really didn't want to go. He may call us to do what we can't imagine doing. You know what the number one fear of most people? The number one fear that most people put down when surveyed of the greatest fear of most people, you know what it is? Public speaking. More so than heights, more so than closed spaces, more so than snakes. The greatest fear of the greatest number of people is public speaking. I never dreamed that I would stand before people and speak anything. I never dreamed that I could get my tongue untangled enough to have anything to say. I still get so nervous. I've been at this 20-some years, and I still get so nervous when I get up here to make announcements or something. Now, in the act of preaching, in the act of doing what God's called me to do, it goes away, and I have a calmness, and I'm able to preach. But just getting up here to make announcements or getting up here to for some other reason, I get so nervous. I look out at people I've been to church with for 25 years, and sometimes I can't call your name. I want to call on you to pray, and I can't come up with your name. I mean, that's how... But in the act of preaching, you see, God don't necessarily call the able. He enables the called. And so when you're actually in the act of doing what He's called you to do, He'll give you a calmness. He'll give you the ability to carry it out. But we cannot do it on our own. But the Holy Spirit enables us to endure hardship or to do whatever it is that Christ has called us to do in following Him. That's what discipleship is all about. It's about saying, Lord, here I am, send me. It's about saying, Lord, I trust You that whatever You ask is going to be okay, so I'll go ahead and commit to it. I'll go ahead and say, yeah, I'll do that favor. I'll do that whatever You're asking before You've even revealed what it is. See, I'm not holding anything back. Accepting this challenging invitation makes life worthwhile. One of the excuses or delays that I had in yielding to God's call was I had a job that I loved, and my wife had a good job, and we thought we had the world by the tail. I mean, things were going the way we had, you know, planned it all out, and everything was. We had bought a home and was able to lay some by. I mean, I thought everything was coming up rosy, and God interrupted my plan. And I told Him that. That just wasn't my plan. And His plans are best, right? His ways are best. His plans are best. See, He wasn't going to call me to do something. He wasn't going to provide the means to do it. These last years of having yielded to Him, to His call, and doing what He's asked me to do have been the best part of life because it's been the blessed part of life. See, the blessed life is the best life. And in holding back, we lose the best in life. In holding back, we may have our way. We may have things going the way we had planned them, but we lose the best of life because we lose many of the blessings of life. Think about that. How many blessings of life, blessings from God, have you missed by holding back from Him? When we totally yield, let Him have His way. Commit, Lord, whatever it is You ask, I'm willing. Then we can have His blessings and we can have the best of life. In verse 35, He said, for whosoever shall save his life shall lose it. But whosoever shall lose his life for My sake and the gospel's the same shall save it. Have you received Christ as Savior? This is your day. Because Jesus is calling. The Spirit is calling and pleading and directing. Jesus has paid your price. He's made the way for you to be saved. If you have been saved, are you now following Him as a disciple, a follower and learner of Jesus? Jesus said, whosoever will come after Me. The invitation is open to all who will hear, receive, and believe. Why not come today? Forget self. Surrender fully to Christ. And follow Him. Will you come to Him? Will you come to Him for salvation? Will you come to Him for discipleship? Let's stand. As we offer an invitation unto Christ, will you bow with me, dear Father? We thank you today for salvation. We thank you today for your Son Jesus, for the love that prompted you to make it salvation available for us. We thank you, God, for the opportunity to serve you, to be a disciple, to follow you. I just ask, Lord, that you cause us to right now quit holding back. Say, today I commit, Lord, to you. You reveal to me what you want. I'm willing. And have our best life because it'll be our blessed life. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.